Good morning everyone, and welcome to this second day live interaction session on this course on pedagogies for integrating ICT in online and blended mode for effective teaching and learning. Today's session, while we are still waiting for some remote centers to join in, we will just get started because they can join in as we go along. So today's session is about how to integrate videos, simulations and screencasts in teaching and learning. So before we dive into it, let us consider a series of teaching learning scenarios. Okay, you will be familiar with these scenarios, and there is a question at the end of the scenarios. So in the first case, a teacher is lecturing on a topic for 1 hour and the students simply listen. In the second case, the teacher is lecturing, but every 20 minutes she pauses and asks, "Did you understand?" Now some students nod and the teacher continues. This is the second scenario. In the third case, instead of simply asking, "Did you understand?" the teacher asks, "Do you have any doubts?" So 3 students raise their hands, teacher clarifies the doubts and then resumes the lecture. In a slightly more involved case, the teacher every 20 minutes asks the students to clarify their notes with each other. So each student turns to their neighbor, discusses their notes, and then the class continues. In a slightly more involved case, the teacher lectures on the topic for 20 minutes. She then poses a real life application problem based on that topic. Now students discuss in groups of 3 to 4 and devise solution to the problem. At the end, the teacher wraps up by conducting a discussion of challenging points and summarizes the solutions. And the final scenario is the teacher starts the class with a debate on the pros and cons of the 2 methods that was taught in the last class. Okay, students work in groups, come up with pros and cons, and then the teacher summarizes which is a better method for which situation, poses a complex problem, and then students work in groups to choose the method to solve the problem. Now while the scenarios, the latter scenarios may seem a bit complex, the question that I want you to think about is, in the series of teaching learning scenarios, some things are changing from one scenario to another. So what you need to do is, you need to think individually and write 2 quantities which are increasing. Okay, quantities may be things like, okay, students' engagement or students' motivation, or it could be something to the teacher, the teacher's effort, and so on and so forth. So if you have had time to grasp the question, I will put the scenarios again for you to look at. So these are the scenarios. What you need to do is go through the scenarios and identify 2 things that are increasing in going from one scenario to the next. Okay, so if you have spent some time thinking about it individually and identified 2 quantities which are increasing, what you need to do next, as we know in think, pair, share, there is a think followed by a pair followed by a share. So in the pair phase, turn to your neighbor and compare your answers. See what your neighbor has written and together come up with at least 1 change related to students and 1 change related to the teacher. So now we go into the share phase, where participants can share your student related change and teacher related change with fellow participants and coordinators in the RC. The coordinator is requested to facilitate this discussion and then share the most frequent answer from your center via AVU. So what I will do now is, since we are sharing desktop sharing, so I will go out of desktop sharing mode and look at the chat window to see some of the answers that you are sending me. Okay, so I am seeing answers like students are more engaged in the activity, teacher's role becomes facilitators, change of student point of view, students become learners, students are more involved in active learning. So many people are saying that the student involvement increases and the teacher's role is changing to a facilitator. Some people are also saying that there is increased interaction between the student and the teacher, as well as increased interaction among students. Students' understanding increases, students become attentive, more and more students get involved in the discussion as we go down the strategies. Thinking ability of the student as well as the teacher gets enhanced, that is a good one. Okay, multiple solutions may emerge, change from teacher centric to student centric, students are engaged in more discussion, slow learners can understand easily, more output from the teaching, teacher satisfaction can increase, attitude is addressed. Students are actively engaged in learning beyond the classroom hours. Somebody is saying syllabus may not get completed, we will address that question later on. Students are becoming active in class. Information transmission to assimilation reduces absenteeism, that is also possible. Okay. So, now that we have seen a number of responses which are falling into some categories, we will go to see what, how can we categorize these responses. So, here what we see is what is changing in the scenarios. In the first case, as many of you have pointed out, students are doing more on their own. So, there is a lot more activity being done by the students. There is more meaningful activities within the class. So, there are students are writing, discussing, solving problems. Students are more engaged with the content, there is more collaboration, as many of you have pointed out, there is more collaboration increases, the discussion on the content with each other increases, there is also more reflection on what they were learning. So, many of these points you have already also identified and pointed out. In the case of teacher, as again you have pointed out, the teacher, there is less talking, the teacher is becoming more of a facilitator in class, and the point which many have thought about is that the teacher has to now put in effort out of the class to design these activities. So, that is where the effort is for the teacher, it is not in the class but before the class. So, since you have already become familiar with active learning, I am happy to see that many of the responses that have come are matching with what we thought as should be the responses. So, essentially in summary, what we see is that more active learning is happening in the class as we go from the information transmission towards more and more learner centric or making students do something type of a model of teaching learning. Now, let us recall what is active learning. It is an approach to teaching and learning whose goal is to engage students with the content via specific activities that get students to talk, write, reflect and express their thinking, right. This again we are familiar with. You have also seen two examples of active learning, you have experienced that as student mode, where one of them was peer instruction and the other of them was think pair share. Yesterday also you experienced it, today also you will be experiencing it, and later on in the course you will be creating your own activities for your students to do active learning. So, now the question for today, the main question for today. So far we have recapped and we have warmed up. So, the main question for today is, now that there is a lot of multimedia content available, how do we do active learning with multimedia? This is basically the overall gist of our discussion today. So, when we talk about using visualizations in class, okay, many of you may have been familiar with the visualizations. So, the picture on your left hand side is a simulation. So, this is from one of our projects called Project Oscar, where it is a simulation of a two arm manipulator, where the student can manipulate these variables and look at things and so on. So, this is one type of visualization that teachers are used to showing in class. Another type is an animation, where, which is on the right hand side, where we are seeing some flow of particles through a system, and the teacher explains about what is happening in the animation. Similarly, you may have other types of videos which you use along with your teaching learning process. So now these visualizations such as animations and simulations have been shown to provide many learning benefits, especially in the STEM discipline. So many teachers report using such visualizations in their class. Okay. Most of them play or demonstrate the animation in class along with a narrative explanation. Now the question is, suppose the teacher shows a visualization such as a video or a simulation or a screencast, and every 20 minutes she pauses the video and explains what the student should observe from the visualization. For example, she may say, okay, look, this is what is happening in the visualization, note that what is happening, and so on. Okay. So the question to you is this teacher doing active learning? Okay. So we are not yet discussing, we want first participants to individually write your answer in your notebook. So there, it's a poll, it's a yes or no poll. So once again, I will repeat the scenario. The teacher is showing a visualization and providing a narrative explanation along with the visualization. Is this teacher doing active learning? So we want participants to individually think and choose your answer. It's a simple yes or no answer at this point. So if you have thought about it and picked your answer, it doesn't matter which answer you pick, because the next phase we are going to do some debate about it. So turn to your neighbor and discuss whether both of you agree on this answer or not. So if you have a yes answer and I have a no answer, you and I have to debate and argue so that both of us either converge on yes or both of us either converge on no. And the coordinator is requested to encourage discussion among pairs. Subsequently, we will take responses from you. So there is no need to start sending responses right away. Okay, so if you have had some discussion on this, we can move to the next phase, which is that each participant pair should indicate your converged answer to the RC workshop coordinator. So it's either a yes or a no, and the coordinator can share the majority answer. So we have not yet set up the AVU poll, so you can just simply share the majority answer through the AVU chat window itself. So I'll just take a look at some of the answers. So I am seeing yes, yes, no, 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 no. Bunch of no's. Some of them are saying yes. Some people are saying no. So there seem to be a lot more no's than yeses. So what I will ask now is that those who think it is yes should simply give one reason, one short reason for why you think it's yes. I will continue to look at the chat window. The no people can just hold off for a while. So if you think it's yes, why is it yes? So some people are, so the no people have actually started giving some response saying students are not interacting in this scenario. Okay. Yes, because she explains about the visualization to the student. No, because the involvement of the student is less. Yes, because teacher is looking at the reflection. Since it's a visual effect, students will be more involved. Only one side interaction. No, because the students become dependent on the videos. Yes, because of involvement of the student. Students are not expressing about their understanding. Instead of listening, students see the videos and understand. No, because feedback is not there. Yes, because it is active participation. Yes, because it creates interest in students. Okay, so we can stop here. So let's see what happens. So many of you have said yes because it engages the student, it makes the student pay attention to the class, it may also help them to remember the content, and so on and so forth. However, if you see the question is saying, is this teacher doing active learning, right? So when we see, the answer to this is actually no, And why is it no? It is no because if you recall active learning, what we want is that the instructor to create carefully designed activities that require students to reflect and express their thinking, the students' thinking, and majority of the students go beyond listening, copying of notes and execution of prescribed procedures. So, now in this case, if the teacher is going to show the video and give a commentary along with the video, it is very similar to doing a lecture, except that now we have some more attractive multimedia to engage the student's attention. It is like having a textbook which explains the matter in a better manner. So, we are using the affordances of multimedia simply to explain better, and as a result of which, if you look at the role of the student is still in a passive role, simply watching the video and listening to the explanation of the teacher. So, we find that the students are not required to talk, write, reflect or express their thinking. They are simply required to watch the video and listen to the teacher's explanation. It is not much different from the teachers simply lecturing also. So, what we want is that majority of students need to go beyond listening, copying of notes and execution of these prescribed procedures. So, the question is, how do we do that in a video? So, we have already seen how to do that in a classroom scenario, right? I mean, what we have already seen is that instead of simply lecturing in a teacher-centric mode, we can have students to do activities, we can create activities like peer instruction, we can create activities like think, pair, share, and all of that to explain concepts which we would have normally simply explained through a lecture. So, now the question is, instead of simply having a lecture, suppose you have a video or a visualization along with the lecture, what can you do to go beyond just engaging the student? Note that the video does serve the purpose of engaging the student's attention, maybe motivation, maybe also helping them to remember, but we are now talking about learning. What is it that we can do with the video to increase the student's learning, to make the student go from being passive to do some active learning? So, for that, first let us see some research results on the use of visualizations. Before we get into that, there is a lot of research which says that showing a demo alone is not effective, especially for student learning. So, once again I repeat that it may be effective for student attracting the student's attention. It may even be effective for helping the student to remember. However, it is not effective for student learning to happen. And the potential benefits of visualization is lost if students merely watch videos in a passive manner. So, the point is, the way the instructor teaches with the visualization has a profound effect on the learning effectiveness. Our own research has also shown that active learning strategies along with visualization leads to improved outcomes. By outcomes, we mean demonstrated outcome in terms of student learning, that they can apply the knowledge that they have gained, they can do analysis and so on. So, active learning strategies with visualization leads to more better outcomes than simply viewing visualization. Simply viewing visualization is almost equivalent to simply lecturing. So, the question now becomes, how to incorporate active learning strategies along with videos? So, given this question, let us look at one video and then examine how to do that. Okay, so, I will just put up one screen here. So, I hope you can see the picture on the screen. So, what I will do is, I will just simply describe what is happening. What we see on the picture, so I am not yet playing the video, I am just pause the video at a point so that you can understand what is going on. So, what is happening here is that there is a trolley and there is a balloon which is tied to the base of the trolley. So, you can just about barely see a string here which is tying the balloon to the base of the trolley, and the balloon is encased in a glass box. So, there is air in the glass box and all that. And now what this person is going to do is, this person is going to push the balloon ahead, push the trolley ahead. Okay, so this is the direction of the motion. So what we see here as the red arrow is the direction of the motion. The balloon is freely hanging inside the cart. So it is tied to the base of the cart, but the balloon is not touching the ceiling or anything, and there is air in the cart. And what this person is going to do is this person is going to push the balloon, push the cart ahead. And the question for us now is to check what will happen to the balloon. So once again, don't start discussing till you have chosen your answer. So there are three choices here. The one that we see, the first one that could be, is that as soon as the person pushes the trolley, the balloon will move forward. The second option is that as soon as the person pushes the trolley, the balloon will move backward. And the third option is that the balloon will stay in the same place. So what you need to do is, you need to think about it individually and write your answer in your own notebook. Okay. So we have all had such experiences of sitting in a bus, a train, a plane and so on. And so using our own experience also, we can imagine, suppose you are the balloon, what will happen to you and things like that. So having imagined what will happen, or having thought about what will happen to the balloon, you need to pick one of these three choices. Does it move forward? Will it move backward? Or will it stay in the same place? So if each of you have picked an answer, we can go to the pair phase, where you turn to your neighbor, discuss and converge on your answer. See, it's not sufficient to simply pick an answer. You also need to have a reason for why you think that it will happen like that. So turn to your neighbor and see whether your neighbor also agrees that it will do what you think it will do, and you need to converge. So if you have different answers, you have to argue with your neighbor that no, it's going to happen this way because of whatever reason that you think. Once again, the coordinator is requested to encourage this discussion among the pairs. So I'll give you some 2-3 minutes to discuss what you think is going to happen. So while you're discussing, what I will do is, instead of you sharing your answers through the AVU chat, I will just set it up as a poll, so that the RC coordinator can simply poll and then all of us can see what different people are saying. So you can ignore what's happening on the screen for a while we just set it up quickly as a poll. So we just need to put those two, three options. So now what we are doing is, we have created this question. Instead of sending your responses through the chat, what you can do is, you can simply send your response through the poll. So it will be kind of easier for everybody to see what the result is. Okay, so there are a whole number of people who are saying that it will stay in the same place. There are some people who are saying it will move in the forward direction, and there are the number of people who are saying it's going to move back is increasing. So what we are finding is that a large number of people are saying that it's going to stay in the same place, while the second option is that people are saying it's going to move backward, and while there are about very few people who are saying that it will move in the forward direction. So now that you have seen these choices, so we have, let's just note down the numbers, 73 RCs thinking that it will stay in the same place, we have 45 thinking that it will move backward, and we have 7 thinking that it will move in the forward direction. So what we will do is, now that you have seen the answers from the other RCs, let's do this poll one more time and see if people want to change your answers. So we will start the same poll again. Now that you have seen what others are saying, you just want to see whether, do you want to change your answer. Once again, the question is, as soon as the person starts pushing the trolley, okay. So you need to think of it at the moment when the trolley starts to move, and not at, you know, after the trolley has come to rest again and so on and so forth. I'll give you one more round of, since you have seen the others' answers, let's see if anybody wants to revise their answers. Okay, so we have about 64 responses which say that it will stay in the same place, We have 44 responses which say that it will move in the backward direction, and we have 6 responses which will say that it will move in the forward direction. So there has not been much of a change in the responses from the previous version of the poll. So now what we can do is we will watch this video and we will see what happens. Okay, so you see that the video has played. I hope you are able to see. So I will play it one more time. So here the person is about to start pushing the cart, and then if we pause the frame right here, what do you observe has happened to the balloon? Okay, so when you see the video, once again I will play it. When you see the video, you see that the balloon has actually moved forward as soon as the person has pushed the cart, right? So I will go back to the main screen. So what we find is that in this case some very curious thing has happened. So many people thought that it will stay in the same place, but then also many people others, the second answer was that it will move backward, but we find actually that when we play the video, the balloon actually moves in the forward direction. So now if this were a physics course, we would get into how, why does this happen? We would get into, okay, what is happening to the air inside the cart? We would talk about terms like inertia and so on and so forth. So that is not the purpose of our discussion right now. So our discussion is to how do we want to use the video. So typically what would happen is, so if you remember when we asked the previous question, that if we were doing it in this mode where the teacher shows a visualization, she pauses and explains what the student should observe and so on, what might have happened is that the teacher may have played the visualization all through, and the teacher would have said, okay, look students, the balloon is moving forward, and here is the explanation for why the balloon moves forward and so on and so forth. And as teachers, we would be happy assuming that our students have understood. So often this is the way we use videos in our class. We play the video and we give an explanation along with the video. Whereas what we find now is that in this case, when we paused the video and asked a question, we found, that's when we found what is the real understanding of our students in this scenario. So for example, here we found that most people thought it's going to stay in the same place. So as an instructor, if I were a physics instructor, that is very useful information for me, because I know how my class is thinking. I know where their misconceptions are likely to be by pausing the video. So essentially, as a result of pausing the video, what has happened is that the students have been made to think, students have been made to discuss, and whatever is their prior conceptions, that has come out. So this is a very simple idea of pausing the video. So when we do active learning with visualization, a very simple way of doing this is to divide it into multiple phases. Instead of simply playing the video and giving a running commentary along with it, what we do is we first say that let's play the video up to a certain point. So in this case, the video is played up to the point where the stimulus is shown, right? So in this case, the stimulus is the person pushing, and what the students are asked to do is to observe the first part of the visualization. So it need not be just a video, it can be any sort of a visualization. It can be an animation, it can be a simulation where you say that, okay, now I am setting the value of these variables to be such and such values, and then you pause. So that pause is the important part of active learning with visualization. So having paused, what you do next is exactly what I demonstrated, which is you ask the students to predict. So the teacher asks, what will happen if, a question like, okay, what will happen if, when the guy is pushing the cart, will the balloon move forward, will it going to move backward, or is it going to stay in the same place? So this is the example question that we asked along with this video, right? So here is where the entire learning happens. The learning does not happen while simply showing the video. The learning happens when you are asking the students to think about what will happen, to predict. So even if it is a video which is not a predict type, for example, we are saying that let us say it is a visualization, it is an animation of some let us say the circulatory system or something. Once again, even when we are trying to teach a concept, we can always pause the video and ask a meaningful question to trigger the student's thinking. So that is the idea. So in this, for this particular video, the question that triggers the student's thinking is a question which says, what will happen if? In another video, the question may be, can you explain what happened? So having done this, having made the students think, then the teacher goes on to the final phase where you say, okay, I am now going to check, okay, I am now going to show the rest of the visualization, and the students now check their own prediction by watching the result of the visualization. So that is when you show the rest of the movie. So it is a very simple idea. Instead of showing the entire movie in the beginning, you show the movie up to a certain point and pause. Having paused, you ask a question to the students which triggers their thinking, and there you can use any of the standard classroom active learning techniques such as peer instruction or think pair share, whichever is suitable, to make the students think, to bring out their prior conceptions, to make them discuss with each other. And once they have put in some thought, then you show the rest of the movie. And now what will happen is, some students will find that their prediction did not match with what is being shown in the video. So this is the time where deep learning happens. Because my prediction did not match in the video, I am going to be now curious as to why it did not match. What is there in my understanding which was not valid, which caused me to make the wrong prediction? So there, that is when the teacher can engage. So if this were a physics class, once again, the teacher would engage in a deep discussion of why the phenomenon is happening in this manner, why is the balloon moving forward instead of what we normally think it might have to move backward, and so on. What is the role that the air inside the cart is playing? What is the role that the pushing action is doing, and so on. So all of these things. Now what happens is, because the students have already picked an answer, they pay more attention to what the teacher is saying, and they try to reconcile their prior knowledge with the correct knowledge, so to speak, in this case, as to what will happen to the balloon. So instead of simply showing a video, what we want to do is show it up to a certain point, ask a question, and then show the video and go on with the discussion as to why the predictions were likely to be wrong, what is the conception that needs to be changed so that everybody comes to the same understanding of the phenomenon. So if that makes sense, we will do one more example. So here is an example. So whatever we looked at for video also holds. So the same idea, so that is why I have used the word visualization instead of a video, because in this case it is a video, but this could well have been an animation, or it could well have been a simulation, and the same pause, predict and continue model will work for that. So now moving to a different type of visualization, many of us use screencasts, right. So let us look at one example from a course that I teach, which is CS101, where often we have questions of this type, okay. Predict the output of the following program. So in this case, okay, this is a pointers question. So those of you who are not from CS background need not worry about what is happening, except that what is going to happen is that we are going to execute this program, and what we have asked students to do is to predict what is going to be the final output. So the Cout statement is actually the output statement, and we are asking students to predict what will be the final output of such a program. So once again, when we use screencasts in our class, what we do is, we often program this in the learning environment and we ask this question, and then we say, okay, what values will be printed? And then students have to simply say that, okay, the value of A will be this, the value of star P is going to be that, and so on and so forth. So instead of doing that, now if we have a screencast, once again there is a very interesting way in which we can use this mechanism. So the idea remains the same. the idea is still saying that, okay, ask the students to predict the output. So what's happening is, what I have done is I have taken the same program that we saw here and I have put it into a programming environment, because this is my screencast environment. However, I have made one change to the program. So the change is that I have put in play statements which makes the program pause. Okay, so I have put in an input statement which is a dummy input statement, which will make the program pause after statement 12. Again, it will make the program pause after statement 22. It will make the program pause after statement 29. So if you look at these statements, these are nothing but these three statements. So what I have done is I have put a pause just before the statement and just after each of these statements. And what I do in the class is that instead of running the entire program at one go, I run the program now, but then now I know that the program is going to pause. So what happens is you ask the student to predict the output at this first point. So what is the output? Each time the output is the same, we are printing the values of A, P and star P and star Q. Okay. So when we do this, in a screencast setup, what happens is after the program is executed up to this point, we find that there is some output which we see. A is 1, B is 2 and C is 3, and then the value of star P is 1 and the value of star Q is 2, while these are the actually the memory addresses of P and Q. So we need not go into the, once again, we need not go into the content details of what is happening. What is important is to follow the teaching learning process over here. What is the teaching learning process? The teaching learning process is make the program pause, make the students predict, and then move the program to the next step. So here itself, some students may not have this prediction correct. So as soon as the students see that, oh look, the prediction that I made and what is actually happening in the program is different, they start paying more attention. They start engaging more deeply with the content. And they start engaging with you also in saying that, why is my prediction not true? So, and that gives you an opportunity to explain that, look, what is actually happening is what is shown here, that you have A, B and C as the variables which have been initialized, and now initially P is pointing to A and Q is pointing to 2. So that is how these values of star P and star Q are 1 and 2. Having done that part, once again now the idea is not to simply play the rest of the program, but to go to the next statement. So it is stopped here, and the next statement, what is happening is there is an assignment that is happening. C is equal to star P. So we say that, okay, you have already seen the output of the first statement. Now tell me what is going to happen after this statement is executed, which says C is equal to star P. Once again, now students make a prediction. Having made the prediction, now the teacher's role is simply to play it up to the next breakpoint in the program. So when the teacher goes to the next breakpoint, now what happens is, again, many of the students will see that, okay, the value of C has now changed to 1. While the values of star P and star Q are remaining the same. So once again, there is no need for us to get into the nitty-gritty of what exactly this program is doing, but simply to get the idea that when we have a program or a simulation or a screencast, what we can do is, this is a very strong feature that we have as teachers, to be able to pause the program, make the students predict something and then continue. So once again, after the students have predicted, we repeat the same thing for the next statement. So after P is equal to Q, once again now the students can check that, oh look, the value of now star P is changing to the same as the value of Q, and they also see that the memory address to which they are pointing has also become equal. And then finally, when we reassign the values, the students can see what is the output of their program. So what happens when we do it in this manner is that, like as you can see on the screen, that each of the pauses, the values at the end of every pause is also captured in your screencast, because now we are doing a screencast rather than a simulation. So the values that were predicted earlier, the intermediate values which are taken by the program, they can also be seen. And at this point, at the end of the program, now the teacher can engage in a meaningful discussion of saying, why the behavior of the program is in this manner. So, the main point here is, instead of simply asking students to predict the output of the program, in this case what is happening is the students have to execute the program mentally and simply say that, okay, what is going to be the final values of A, B and C, what is going to be the final value of star P and star Q. This is the traditional way of teaching with screencasts. Instead of doing that, what we do is we pause the screencast at several points. So, as a teacher you will know where to pause the screencast or the simulation. We pause it at several points, we ask the students to predict, and then as a result the students not only predict the final output, which in this case happens to be 1, 13 and 1, but they are also able to see the intermediate steps and also predict what they think should be at the intermediate step. So, this process of making the student predict, making the student think, making them reconcile their answer with the actual answer, be it a video or be it a screencast, this process adds a lot of value to the learning. So, the main takeaway of this session is very similar to the previous one, which is make students grapple with content during the class. How did we do that? We do that by saying that let us not only clarify doubts, let us provide frequent opportunities for learners to work with the content, which is use of active learning techniques. Let us ensure immediate and appropriate feedback to the learners, which is in terms of peer discussion. There is one additional thing from the previous session. So, these two points you have already encountered in the previous session. So, now in this session what we are seeing is the additional point. So, the additional point is that when we want to do peer instruction, there is a very simple way of doing that, which is don't just keep your MCQs for the exam. Make the students do them during the class. That is a very effective way of carrying out peer instruction in the class. The second point is about think, pair, share, where the point is don't just lecture or don't just explain what the student is expected to learn. Make the students do first, make them express their own thinking and then bring the explanation at the end. So, instead of having the explanation in the beginning and the problem to be solved at the end, we put the problem to be solved in the beginning, let the students work on it in some manner and then put the explanation at the end. So, we are just flipping. So, this is again the basic idea of a flipped classroom, which is being implemented within the classroom itself in this think, pair, share activity, where we make the student first solve the problem and then give the explanation, instead of first giving the explanation and then giving the problem. And finally, with visualizations, the idea is we do not want to just show the visualization and provide the corresponding explanation. Instead, we make the students predict the outcome. So, pause the visualization at some appropriate point, make the student predict, make them discuss as to why they think their prediction is correct, then continue with the visualization, let them verify whether their prediction is correct or not, once again pause the visualization, carry out a discussion for those whose prediction was not correct as to why their prediction was not correct, what might be the reason, and then so on. We keep continuing that process with the same visualization or the same screencast till the students have attained a deeper understanding of the phenomenon or the program. So, this is the main takeaway from this today's interaction. So, I am going to skip this poll because this is again the same poll as what was carried out yesterday. I thought we can carry out this poll again, maybe I will do that. So, what I will do is I will reactivate the poll. So, now in this case, instead of asking the question as will you implement active learning in your class, the question is will you implement active learning with visualization in your class. Okay, so, there is an overwhelming number of people who are saying yes, definitely more than once, and an equal number of people who are saying that they will try at least once. So, it is very encouraging to see that lot of you want to try these techniques. So, this is very simple. So, in the case of visualization, so what we can do is we can simply look at pause the video visualization at an appropriate point and then move on. So, what is important now is to look at the concerns of those who said that, okay, we have concerns. So let me now, I will pause my talking since I have been talking for nearly an hour. So I will stop here, and then we will go into an interaction mode where we can actually do floor transfer to some of the RCs, and then you can do a hand raise. So either you can send your questions through the chat, or you can do a hand raise and ask your question. So especially those who have concerns, I would like to see what your concerns are and see if they can be addressed. So we will stick to the topic of visualizations, active learning with visualizations. We need not talk about, you know, other concerns like, yeah, go ahead.
My question is, flipped class can be easily worked for a smaller classroom, that we have done, but for larger classroom we are having few concerns that the students who are not actively engaged, maybe 2%, are carrying over the entire activity.
Okay, so the question is that if these ideas of active learning may work well for a small classroom, but how do they make them work in a large classroom? So the point here is, when you set up the activity like a peer instruction activity or a think pair share activity, every student has to participate in that activity. So what happens as a result is that it's not possible for students to be tuned out. If we were doing this activity in a very informal manner, in that case what will happen is, we'll wind up talking only to the first few benches, we'll wind up talking only to those students who are responding to us. So that is why it's important to structure these activities in a manner so that all students are forced to participate. So when we say that here is a peer instruction question, each one of you has to pick an answer. Students, it does not matter what the size of the class is. Like, for example, I have used these classes in my CS 101 course, where there are 450 students at one time in the class. So even in such a large class, because we are setting it up saying that there is an individual component and there is a peer discussion component, it is possible to carry out both flipped classroom as well as active learning activities in the class. So the important thing as instructors we have to keep in mind is, we have to create these activities, we have to create these questions and spend some time in structuring it such that the entire class is involved. It's not enough for us to just have the question in our mind and simply ask it. It's desirable to make one slide where these questions are explicitly written and where we have said what is expected from each student to do.
Yes, actually our question was same, how to implement it for larger class.
Okay.
And actually we want to thank you, because what we were thinking, that just showing multimedia videos, animation, promoting active learning, but just we come to know that there must be some way to implement that.
Okay,
thanks for this nice lecture.
Okay, so thank you very much. We will go to the next RC 1299, Dronacharya College of Engineering.
Sir, I want to implement active learning in my teaching methodology, but my main concern is that the syllabus of BTech Civil Engineering is so vast that it is merely impractical to apply these kinds of things in my teaching methodology.
Okay, so
can you suggest any method so that the time can be fully utilized?
Okay.
Along with the full completion of the syllabus.
Yeah, so the question is that in this case of active learning, it appears that it takes a lot of time, and this is a very common concern about whether I will be able to complete the syllabus. So now there are two ways to approach this. One way is that when we are lecturing, we believe that we are completing the syllabus, but we have not paid much attention to how much learning has happened. So the first question you need to think about is, what is the value of completing the syllabus if the learning of the student is less, if the student still has to put in all the effort to learn on their own later on. Okay, so that is the first thing. And the second thing that you will find when you implement active learning is that, because students are engaging with the content more deeply. So normally what happens is, students are going to come to the class, they are going to sit like that, listen to us. We are going to assume that they are understanding, but as we know, the understanding has really not happened. And what they will do is, they will study just before the exam, they will cram and they will somehow try to understand it everything on their own. Instead of that, what we are doing is we are giving them opportunities to understand the content more deeply in the class itself. So while it appears that it will take longer, in fact what happens is it takes less time because students are able to grasp the contents as well as apply them. When we go to the next topic, we find that students are able to keep up. So I can only give you examples from my own courses. So I teach CS 101, I teach networking, and in both of these courses what I have found is that initially it may take a bit longer for the students to get used to this format, but once they get used to it, we find that students engage more deeply with the content, so they ask more deeper questions, as a result of which a lot of the material that you would have thought that I have to cover later in the syllabus actually gets covered in a shorter time, and they also progress much faster. So this is something which right now you can only take it on faith, but when you implement it in your class, you will see it happening in your classroom also, that students are actually engaging more deeply with the content, and because students are engaging more deeply with the content, it becomes easier for you to cover the syllabus rather than more difficult.
These kind of assessments are very interesting, in fact, but in a given course, like some are through screencasts, some are through videos, some are through offline quizzes and kind of thing. So how this summative grading can be made possible? Like, is there any integrated software environment where all this can be taken into account? And finally, I should not again have a manual intervention where I did three questions through this screencast method, another through videos for a database of 60 or 100 students. It's highly impossible for me to have an accountability for each question in which way what I have done. So how this can be made possible?
Okay. So the question is that how can we integrate these questions that we are asking with the assessment? So now there is a point that we have to keep in mind here. One is that this is formative assessment that we are doing in the class. So this is not, the purpose of this assessment is to ensure that the student's knowledge deepens rather than to determine how much knowledge they have. On the other hand, so in effect what I am saying is, yes, you will have to write different questions for the summative assessment at the end of the class, but then that also can be done in these online manner. So like in the next session, we will be talking about how you can use Moodle for conducting such assessments, but there is really no getting away with the fact that you have to set your summative assessment question. So these questions that you are using in the class, they are actually for the formative assessment. By formative assessment, what we mean is that so that the students get to know how much they know, and you as the teacher also get to know how much you know, how much they know, so that you can tailor your teaching learning according to the needs of the students. So that is the purpose of these questions which you are using during the class. At the end of the class, or at the whenever the exam comes up, that is when you may use similar questions for the summative assessment also, but you cannot use the same questions. So you can have a different video, or you can have a different question on the same video. Those kind of things are possible. So RC1101, your video is not visible, but you can go ahead and ask the question. Let's see if the audio comes through.
Yeah, sir, I just wanted to know, is there any format of how to evaluate the TPS activity?
Okay, so this question is similar to the previous one about using TPS for evaluation. So the purpose, like I said, the purpose of TPS is learning. The purpose of TPS is not to evaluate. So what you could do, so that even if we are evaluating, the purpose of the evaluation is for the instructor to know how much the students have learnt and what is the teaching that they have to do next. So the way to evaluate is when you are getting answers. Like for example, if you take the video, balloon video that we saw today, most people gave the response that the balloon will stay in the same place or it will move backward. Whereas actually what happened in the video was that the balloon moved forward. So as soon as the teacher sees that, okay, most people are thinking that it's going to stay in the same place, the teacher can do some additional teaching at that point, maybe even an explanation at that point as to why it will not stay in the same place, what is the reason for that misconception, and why actually it's going to move forward. So that is the way in which you can use TPS or you can assess what is happening in the TPS. Using TPS for finally in the assessment and giving marks to students is not a good idea. So, that you would actually do using projects, and then you would use rubrics for evaluating the projects, whether the students have done the various steps and so on.
Sir, we wish to implement all these techniques which are very useful, I think so. But the one thing is how we can implement all these techniques in a class size of 70 and 90 students. And one thing is how we can manage time, as you explained earlier for previous question also. How we can complete syllabus, it's a very vast syllabus, so in just 3 months how we can complete the syllabus along with these techniques. And when we create, so I sometimes I think then when we create the contents, we should have different team to create content and or we collect content. If we have a different team, in that case we can cope up with these, we can apply these techniques. So, can you suggest some?
Okay. So the first two questions I have already answered earlier. You know, how to implement active learning in a large classroom is that if you create the activity in a structured manner, especially where you have every student has some deliverable, some task which every student has to do, write down their answer and discuss with their neighbor, then the size of the class really does not matter, right? The second question also I have answered, which says that if you use active learning, it appears that it is going to take more time. But in fact, because students are engaging more deeply with the content, it actually takes less time overall to complete the syllabus, because you will be able to move faster. Many of the concepts the students will already discover on their own. The third point that you are making of, can we have a separate team which creates these activities? Yes, we can have a separate team which creates these activities. In fact, that is one of the things that we will be doing as part of this course, is that there will be a repository of open educational resources where you will be creating such peer instruction and TPS activities for your topic, which others can also use. However, the thing to remember is that you cannot simply take somebody else's content and use it. You have to have the lesson plan of your own. So, you have to know that where I am going to use that, how I am going to use it, what am I going to do when I get a certain response from the student. So, the planning nobody else can do for you, you have to do on your own. But the resources in terms of maybe videos, even lecture material, as well as peer instruction questions and TPS questions, these can be created as a community. And that is one of the efforts that we are doing as IIT Bombay. We are trying to create these. So, there will be repositories that we are creating, there are Facebook pages which you can join, and so on. So, many of these things we will talk about in the later sessions. Okay. So, we will take another few colleges. So, if you have the same question, then please do not ask the same question. If you have a different question, then please go ahead.
Sir, my question is, two questions are for me. So, the past 2 days we have seen some of the active learning strategies, but my first question is, which technique to choose to deliver a particular content? There are lots of techniques you have said now. Which is the appropriate technique to deliver a particular content? That's my first question, sir.
Okay. So, can you ask the second question also? I will just reply to both of them.
Sure, sir. These are the active learning strategies that you have listed out. But my concern is, so implementing this in the classroom, yeah, the class would be lively and it will be in interactive mode, but how long it will impact on their writing skills? That is our education pattern I am talking about. Our education pattern is completely mark oriented. Okay. They would learn that, I could ensure. Okay. They would surely learn. Okay. But how could they would write? That's what. Because okay, since it's a marks oriented, all the institutions are expecting our students should get this grade, this percentage of marks. So, in that way I am thinking.
Okay. So, I will take the questions one by one. So, the first question is, which technique to use when? So, this is a good question and there is no very clear answer. I mean, I can do what I am doing using peer instruction also if I use TPS. But the general thumb rule to keep in mind is that if you want to check whether students have understood a concept, peer instruction is a good method. So, if the answer is definite, if it is a yes or no answer, if it is not open-ended, if there are only limited number of choices where some one of which is the correct answer, two of them may be distractors, one of which is the wrong answer, and we want to determine how well have the students understood the concept, then peer instruction is a very easy mechanism to use. On the other hand, if we have more open-ended questions, if we have questions where we want students to do something, to create something, like for example, come up with the, let us say, the idea to solve a particular problem, then it is not possible to structure it as a peer instruction because we do not know what options the students are going to come up with. So, in such cases, think, pair, share is a better mechanism. So, to summarize, peer instruction is better if we know what are the options that we are expecting from students and we want to know which, how many students are taking which option so that we can tailor the instruction accordingly. And think, pair, share is better when the questions are more open-ended, where we want students to come up with answers and discuss and then finally evolve a unified explanation as a class. The other techniques also have similar instances where they can be used, but in the most case, if we are able to use either peer instruction or think, pair, share, for the large part, the class becomes active. The second question was about the assessment, that students are required to write long answers in the assessment. So, now the long answers actually come because the question requires, you know, we write questions like explain something, or we write, okay, give reasons for. So, when we have questions of that type, that is when students have to write long answers. Now, unless the question itself changes, there is nothing that you can do about that. So, what we can do is we can only ensure that students also learn the content. So, any questions which are of the type where students can simply mug up the answer and come and write, there is really nothing you can do until you change the question itself. So, if the question is coming centrally from the university, then the people, some of us who are involved in setting those questions, now need to become aware and we need to set questions which actually assess the student learning rather than assessing the student's ability to recall and regurgitate an answer. Yeah, okay. So, Professor Phatak seems to have joined from Mewa. So, we will just transfer to him.
Good morning and thank you, Professor Iyer. I am delighted to be amongst the participants, but this time I just wanted to say hello. I will address the participants in the next session starting at 11:30. I am keen to listen to the question answers which Professor Iyer is handling so very ably. Over to you. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Okay, so let's go on to RC1343.
Yes. I have one concern. Think, pair and share activity. The central theme of active learning is the student maximum, almost every student's involvement in the course. But the concern is that if most of the students, if they are not ready to involve, suppose if we ask them to think, then some students only think, others remain quiet. And then when I ask them to pair up and share, then in every pair at least one or in some pairs, both were sitting quietly. Okay. They were not getting involved. If I probe them that you think and come up with a solution, they were telling, no, I don't have any idea, and again they were sitting quietly.
Okay.
Most of the students, this was happening.
Okay.
So, how can we improve that?
Okay. So, this is again a very good question. So, clearly you have tried this. So, there are two things that you can do. So, one thing is that the think phase, the question that you set in the think phase should be reasonably easy so that every student is able to give some answer or the other. So, for example, when I tried to teach about sorting algorithms, there are several sorting algorithms, merge sort, quick sort, so on and so forth. So, the question in the think phase that I give is simply that, okay, suppose you had a list of numbers and you had to sort, how will you do the sorting? So, what happens as a result of this is everybody knows how to do sorting. They may not know the name of the technique that they use. They may not know all the formal techniques, but they know that, okay, I will do like this. So, the think phase question should not be very daunting to the student. It should be reasonably easy. Every student should be able to attempt it somewhat from common sense itself. What happens as a result of that is that the student becomes interested in the topic that you are trying to teach. Then in the pair phase, we can go a little deeper. So once everybody has an answer, then I am curious as to what is your answer. So when you say, okay, in the pair phase, now look at how your neighbor has done the sorting. They are always curious to say, okay, will my method work better or will your method work better? They start getting into debate as to what, for what sort of input will there, will one method work better than the other, and so on. So the first thing to do when we are setting up TPS activities is to make sure that the think phase is reasonably easy. Most people can attempt it using, you know, more or less common sense and what they would have already have learnt in maybe in the previous year, and to connect it to the pair phase so that there is some motivation for them to discuss. So there is, there should be some notion of interest in saying, okay, what is your answer, how is my answer different, whose answer is better. So if there is a little bit of that type of excitement, then it will work. One more thing that you can do, if even if this does not work, is to take a short round through the class. So what we do is, so even in a class of 450 when we teach, so after having posed the question, I take a quick round through the class, especially to the groups which are not engaged in the discussion, and just poke them a little bit, saying that, okay, are you stuck, what are you stuck, you know, they respond to something, give them some quick hint, and thereby bring the entire class into the discussion. So this is a very important question, and there are two answers. One is that ensure that the think phase is reasonably easy so that everybody can attempt, and the pair phase is somewhat exciting so that everybody is curious about the other person's answer. And even if that does not work, just take a round through the class and encourage students to participate. So RC 1266.
Good morning, sir.
Vashish. Yeah.
Thank you for a wonderful session. Now this session is about active learning with visualization. Now this is possible if the classroom is equipped with audio video, that means the projectors. Now sometimes I don't have the projectors in my class. So it is possible that I am getting the active learning by presenting a model of an instrument. I used to teach instrumentation measurement, topic measurement. So it is possible to achieve the active learning by model presentation of instruments. Thank you, sir.
Thank you for this question. It's again an important question because it's talking about a different mode of teaching where there is no projector available, but a model is available. So once again, when you are using a model, so I don't have too much experience in teaching with models because we work with software, but the basic idea is still the same. You know, you show the model up to a certain point, you give an explanation up to a certain point, and then you stop and ask a question. So even if you are saying that, okay, I mean the model that I can imagine right now is some, you know, chemistry molecular model or something. So what we do is, instead of simply saying that, look, when we rotate, this is what happens, when we rotate, that's what happens, we can ask the question that, okay, what will happen when I rotate now? What do you think is going to happen? Let the students express their thinking. So the basic goal of all active learning techniques, irrespective of whether we are using it using just plain content or using a visualization or any other teaching aid such as a model, or such as maybe making them do something. So the basic idea is to pause it at a certain point, make the students think, make them give a response, and then proceed with the rest of it.
Sir, my question is regarding piece of active learning techniques in the classrooms. And the activity what will be given for the students is a mini case study report writing through think, pair and share activity. Can I map these activities by designing a rubric, and the rubric will involve the writing skills, the individual and teamwork skills, as well as the communication skills of the student? Can I map these and do the assessment? That is, I'm speaking with respect to OBA procedure. Till now we are in the OBL procedure of learning activities and all, and now I would like to know how to assess these kind of activities.
Okay, so like I said earlier, that the assessment, so there are several types of assessment. So there is assessment of learning and there is assessment for learning, right? So the assessment of learning is what we call as summative assessment, which comes at the end of the course, where we try to find out how much a student knows and give some number to that knowledge. The other one is assessment for learning, where we are doing the assessment so that the learning happens, not of learning. So most of the techniques that we are using in class are assessment for learning. So either the student gets to know where their gaps are, or the teacher gets to know where the gaps are, and then construct the next session in such a way so that those gaps can be addressed. So now what you mentioned of this case study and use of rubric. So one thing that you have to keep in mind is that these in the class, these cannot be very long activities. So if we say so what you need to do is to structure the activity in such a way that there are several pieces. So you may have one long activity which stretches throughout the entire 1 hour, it is possible. But then what is necessary is for you to chunk this activity into small, small pieces. So you do one initial think, pair, share, where you are asking students to do one part of the case study. Then there is a different question after some time where they have to do another part of the case study. So instead of giving all the questions related to the case study in the beginning itself and, you know, letting students work for a long time on it, it is desirable to give one question at a time, one small task at a time, so that students are familiar and they are engaged in the activity, as well as the teacher can get some feedback as to how they have been doing on that activity, whether the next activity is going to make sense or not, and so on. So that's the basic idea, not to use a very large activity, but to use small or break a large activity into multiple small activities and use them one by one. In that case, even case studies or even use of, as you mentioned, the use of rubrics, all of that can be brought into the classroom itself as active learning techniques. Good morning.
Sir, I have two questions regarding this. My first question is, one of the question is already answered, that which technique should be applied when. But another question is when and which technique should be used. Sometimes what happens, the students are discouraged by the so many activities also, or even the long activities if you are doing then also. So what should be our situation, then we can decide that at this particular moment we should apply the active learning technique. That is my first question. Another question is that how can we remap the outcome based education to the active learning techniques, so that based on the student interest or their target, we can apply the different active learning techniques. So the most of the times, okay, the students may be interactive and active also. Thank you, sir.
Okay, so the first question of when should we use which technique, again there is no single correct answer to this question. I mean, you have to, so as teachers we are already familiar with techniques to use in the class when we find that certain groups of students are tuning out, or sometimes you will crack a joke, sometimes you will do something. So you are used to dynamically adapting to what is happening in the class, right? Most of us are already doing that. So in the case of active learning also, it is the same thing. So what is important to keep in mind is we don't want too many activities. As you mentioned, we don't want too many activities. At the same time, we don't want too few activities. So there is no good number. So what I do in my class, for example, is I have one PI question and one TPS question in a 1 hour class. So often that is sufficient to ensure that students are engaged with the content of that particular class. So, or maybe one PI question in the beginning to assess what they have already know, one TPS question which makes them engage with the content of the current class, and one PI question at the end to check whether they have understood or they have reached a good level of understanding of the topic. So such a construction of your lesson plan is sufficient to ensure that students are engaged. So once again, our goal is not to reach 100%. So the thumb rule generally is that if 80% of your class is able to follow 80% of what you want them to learn, then you are doing a good job as a teacher. The 100% is a very difficult target to attempt. So this is called the 80-80 rule, where you say that, okay, if 80% of my class is engaged, 80% of my class is following what I want them to do, then you are in a good situation. For the second question about that OBE, So once again, so there is no connection really between the technique that you use and the assessment. So if it is outcome based education, now what you want to do is, once you know what the learning, expected learning outcomes are, you design activities such that those outcomes can be met, and you need to design assessment questions to check whether those outcomes are met.
Sir, this is Mahbub from Ishwar College of Engineering. We had a doubt that how the active learning method can be implemented in problem based teaching method, sir.
So active learning is one way of doing problem based teaching. Like, for example, the think, pair, share activity that I showed you is also a problem based teaching. So again, these are all very broad terms. Active learning is a very broad term. Problem based learning is also a very broad term. The specific techniques that we are talking about are this TPS. You know, later on, you know, we can also have techniques like team pair solo. So team pair solo is where first you pose a problem where students work on it as a team, then two of them work on a smaller part of the problem but go into more detail, and finally individually the student is doing the entire working out of the detail of the problem. So techniques like think pair share and team pair solo, they are specific ways in which you can incorporate problem based learning in your teaching learning process. Yeah, so now the time is actually 11:15, so I have already eaten 15 minutes into your tea break, and since the next session has to start at 11:30, I think I will have to stop here. There are a few questions, a few more hand raises, but what you can do is you can send your question through the chat and we will address the question either through the forum or maybe in the beginning of the next session. So once again, thank you very much for joining on a Sunday, leaving all your other work, and it's very heartening for us also at IIT Bombay to see the amount of interest that is there, and it encourages us also to conduct more and more such programs. Thank you very much for being here today.